Works 96.7 WORX. Good morning and thank you for tuning in. It is just after 9.05 a.m. here on Telegraph Hill, and it is the final Tuesday in the month of September, and that means it is once again time for Cop Talk. Cop Talk brought to you by Anderson Sales and Services. I'm A.J. Brammer. Thanks for tuning in this morning. And joining me in studio, we have the Sheriff of Jefferson County, John Wallace, and the Chief of the Madison Police Department, Dan Thurston. So, Sheriff, Chief, thank you guys for coming on the show.
Thanks for having us. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, A.J. It's always our pleasure.
Yeah, we definitely appreciate you guys coming on, and good opportunity to talk about some stuff going on with you guys' departments in our area. So, and obviously this past weekend, we had a very busy weekend for a lot of different reasons.
Yes, we did.
So, how did everything go?
Yeah, from perspective of the overall operation, it went extremely well. Of course, as everyone knows very well, we had a KKK rally in Jefferson County. A lot of planning took place for that, both the city, county, and state, and ATF were present for that. State Parole was present as well. It was a major undertaking for us, actually. I mean, several months of planning, and I certainly think that paid off. Everybody left peacefully. Everybody got to say their piece. First Amendment right was protected, and no arrests were made, and no one was hurt. So we in law enforcement consider that a big success.
I think at the end of the day, all law enforcement officials who were involved went into it believing that if everybody went home safely, then it was going to be a successful day. So based on that criteria alone, it was successful as far as law enforcement is concerned. As the sheriff mentioned, as far as First Amendment rights, both sides got to voice their opinions and say their piece. And at the end of the day, everybody went home. One group that I think maybe gets overlooked that I would like to thank would be the City Street Department, because in addition to all of our planning, we then took those plans to Tony Sorrells, the street superintendent, who then was in charge of getting the park ready, if you will, the way we wanted it for the plan, and every detail we gave him was taken care of, and we really appreciate their efforts as well.
Yeah, I'd like to echo that. They did a great job. It was an arduous task to put all the fencing up and to make sure that the barricades and everything was in place, and they just jumped right in to do it. So we are very appreciative of our street department. Chief hit it right on the head. Also, I'd just like to say, I think it was a testament to the citizens of Jefferson County, the protesters who came out, on how they conducted themselves. You know, often every night, it seems like, unfortunately, we see on TV in the larger cities when people come out to protest, how those protests oftentimes turn ugly. We here in Jefferson County were able to come out, conduct a protest, conduct ourselves in an orderly manner, get our point across, and I said go home with no arrest, and everybody's safe. So I would just like to applaud our citizens for the ones who did choose to come down there, on the way they conducted themselves, and the Hanover College students as well. You know, everybody got to say their piece, and again, nobody was hurt. So I think that's a testament to to our citizens here in Jefferson County.
Like you guys said, First Amendment right, you have a right to assembly, right to free speech, so everybody was there for their own reasons, but everybody stayed safe, and it is really cool to see all the departments working together to make sure that
And it's tough. It's tough when you have these these type of situations. I mean, the KKK is a very divisive group, and it's tough to hold emotions back and those type of things. But like I said, I'm very proud of the way the citizens conducted themselves, and they were able to get their point across in a very effective manner without anyone getting hurt. So, at the end of the day, it was a good day.
I would agree.
In addition to what was going on down at Fireman's Park this past weekend, we had quite a bit going on in our area as well. Obviously, Madison Chautauqua going on, one of the bigger festivals in our area. So, but everything went okay with that?
Absolutely, and even the more reason to give kudos to the street department. They have enough to do to prepare for that weekend as it is, with all the barricades and the street closures. So, but no, the event went well. I was down there both days. Of course, after the KKK event, then my wife and I, Jackie and I, were down there for a little bit Saturday, and then went back down on Sunday, and it seemed to go smooth. And a lot of people in town, a lot of hopefully money spent. Hopefully the vendors did well and the restaurants did well. So that's always a great weekend for Madison when the weather cooperates. I know the last couple of years they've had a few issues with weather, and it was warmer than usual, but still it seemed to be a really good weekend with a lot of people out.
You know, I'm always amazed on how our volunteer organizations are able to pull these massive events off. And Chautauqua is certainly one of our, if not the biggest draw. You know, Main Street's packed, Vaughn Drive, all the side streets, and yet they're able to pull it off without a hitch. So, you know, our appreciation goes out to them. It's outstanding for our community. Brings a lot of good folks in town. We get that great opportunity to showcase downtown Madison, which we all love. So, it worked out very well. And like the chief said, we're appreciative of everybody's efforts from the throughout the city and in the organizations as well. It's good for Madison. It really is.
And so we close out one festival, and we do have another one coming up here in a couple of weeks. I believe it is October 8th is the Soup Stew Chili and Brew Festival in downtown Madison. So, you know, it's common rhetoric when we talk about a festival, but we want everybody to have a great time, but we want them to be safe.
Absolutely. And, you know, closing down Main Street's no easy task, but that's turned into a great event. It seems like every year it seems to grow. Every year that I'm down there, it's a little bigger and there's a few more people. And I just think it's neat. Of course, probably one of my vices is eating. So anytime there's food involved, like Soup Stew Chili and Brew, then I'm in. So I'm looking forward to that one.
Yeah, as well. It certainly is one of my favorites too. And fortunately, I think for the third or fourth year in a row, I get to be one of the judges, which you know, I don't mind volunteering doing. You get to sit there and they bring it all to you, so it works out very well. But no, it's a very nice event, and it's kind of an end to the to the summer season. You know, really kick off to the fall, and then we seem like winter comes quickly. But I think everybody certainly enjoys that event as well.
Works 96.7 WORX. Good morning. Thank you for tuning back into Cop Talk, brought to you by Anderson Sales and Services. We do Cop Talk the last Tuesday of each month. AJ Brammer here in studio up on Telegraph Hill, joined once again by Jefferson County Sheriff John Wallace and Madison Police Chief Dan Thurston. Sheriff, we were just talking during the break. You guys recently over the jail had an inspection.
We did. Yeah, we had the state jail inspector come in, as he does every year. The building, the facility, and the bricks and mortar are in good shape. You know, we try to keep that up to date as quickly as something goes wrong. The current facility is about 10 years old now, so unfortunately, things do start breaking down after a 10-year period, and especially the wear and tear that it's put on the facility. But our staff down there does a fantastic job keeping an eye on things and keeping everything repaired. Our big problem is the overpopulation, which is not unusual throughout the state. All counties are experiencing it, some worse than others. Our capacity is 108, and we currently sit at 140 this morning. So you can imagine, you know, what kind of issues that creates. So far, we're able to keep everybody in-house. If we couldn't do that, then that would obviously cost the taxpayers quite a bit more money to ship inmates elsewhere. But to be totally honest with you, I'm not sure where we'd take them to at this point, because every county is experiencing the same issues, and a lot, like I said, even worse. But it's narcotic-related. You know, 80 to 90% of our inmates are narrow on drug-related charges, and we're getting through, but it's a daily challenge. So, as we mentioned earlier, how proud we are and appreciative we are of the street department, I'm equally as proud and appreciative of all my officers and staff, but especially my jail staff right now, because they're really having to go above and beyond the call of duty to take care of these issues. But so far so good. We'll manage and work with the prosecutor and the courts, and do the best we can do to get through this situation.
Right. Like you said, it's a problem that you can't really get yourself out of. People are going to be arrested. Right. People have to go to jail.
Yeah. Unfortunately, they have to go to jail, and a lot of the people are sitting there on some serious narcotic related charges, dealing charges, and we don't want those people out in our community to keep spreading this poison about, because it is poison in our community. So law enforcement is going to stay on top of it. We mentioned before on this show that we're going to stay at it, because we have to. If we don't stay on top of it and we don't continue to be aggressive with drugs, it'll destroy a community, and we're not about to let that happen here in Jefferson County. So we'll stay at it and do the best we can do with what we have.
Chief, obviously the jail falls under the sheriff's jurisdiction, but do you have anything to add to that?
Well, I just want to echo his comments as far as our aggressiveness on the drug situation, and we're fortunate to have prosecutors and judges who are supportive in our efforts, and also with some officers who work those particular cases on a daily basis, and their efforts and time, because those are not easy overnight cases. You don't take a report and do your investigation about 24 hours and file charges. Those take hours and hours and hours of work and documentation and filing the correct paperwork. So as the sheriff said, we're going to stay aggressive. Hopefully, you know, as I don't know what the answer is, if you build onto the jail and make it bigger or what you do, but you know, we're going to keep doing our job on our end, and that end will figure itself out.
Yeah, absolutely. And as we say, we have to. You know, as we see trends keep evolving with the heroin situation, you know, we know that you know, it's being laced with some serious tranquilizers, and you know, so we've had seen communities around us, fortunately not here in Jefferson County, but communities around us where all of a sudden you'll have, you know, 10, 15, 20 people just drop over because of it's, you know, it's laced too strongly. So again, if we don't stay on top of that, you know, these type of things can really take root. So we're not going to let that happen.
Right. You know, part of keeping up on things, you know, having members of your staff that are ready to handle that. I know, Chief, you're about to have a new man on the street, correct?
We will, yeah. We have an officer in the academy right now. Philip Wimpy is our most recent hiree, and he's in the academy. We tried something a little different this year. Plainfield was not going to have an open class for some time. The Indiana Law Enforcement Academy is in Plainfield, but they've started some satellite academies, and the Southwestern Indiana Law Enforcement Academy is in Evansville. So he's actually attending classes in Evansville, and I ran into him over the weekend down at the police station, and he said things are going well, and said he had a tough week last week. It was defensive tactics, and one of the defensive tactics instructor got a hold of him pretty good, I think, a couple times. But you know, that's part of the training, part of the learning, and he said things are going well. However, he's excited to get back and serve the community that, you know, that he was hired to serve, and so he's ready to get back to work. His graduation day is November 11th, and I'll be attending that, and looking forward to seeing him graduate and get back to work.
Yeah. Small departments, one man or one woman can make a huge difference.
Absolutely.
So we're always glad to get them back from the academy. And but once they get back, they're you know, they're still not ready. There's probably, you know, 2 or 3 months still ahead of them of field training and that type of thing. So it's extensive when you know, when we hire somebody, it's a year out before they're really street ready. So
yeah, he'll be the first one. We have for the first time a formal FTO program. We had an SOP written for the FTO program. Field Training Officer Program. Officer Wyatt, Patrolman Wyatt, went to school and has taken some training to become our field training officer. So it will be Officer Wyatt's responsibility, if you will, to put Officer Wimpy through all the training and make sure he's ready to go and sign off on all the training that he's had, so that, as the sheriff said, once, you know, he is ready, and it does take some time. And because we were able to get him to the Evansville Academy so quickly, he really didn't have a lot of training here before he left. So all of that, the formal FTO program really will be starting from zero when he gets back from the academy. So there'll be some time and some training there. Based on my brief interactions with Philip Wimpy, I don't think it'll take him long. I think two things. A, he has the capacity to learn quickly, but also he's eager and wants to learn. So I think he'll be a real asset to our department in this community.
That's excellent. We'd like to see, you know, we like to see people serving. We like to see them serving well. So
absolutely,
the training is definitely beneficial. Just out of curiosity, how much has the training changed from when you guys went through the academy?
Well, I was just thinking of that when the chief was going over everything that that Officer Wimpy's going through. Thinking back about to the days when I started, maybe a little prior to, but they'd say, here's the keys to the car and here's your gun, now go get them. But so, maybe not quite that bad, but it was it's changed a lot, and it certainly has changed for the better. Mm-hmm. And you know, we can't train too much, and we consistently train throughout the year. We have today, for example, we have several different training sessions going on. We have our emergency vehicle operation course training going on, and we have some training at the Hanover Police Department as well. So we never stop training, and you know, it's something that's mandated by the state. We equal that and go above that here in Jefferson County. We work together with the chief and his department and Hanover Police, and we train together because you never know which call you're going to go on, where it may be a mixed match of city and county or Hanover officers. So we work hard, train well together, and and hopefully it pays off when it's needed.
Yeah, we all know that in a stressful situation, which a lot of the situations we go on are high stress levels, that you will fall back on the training that you have, even if it's subconscious and you're not thinking about, you know, what we did in training. It just happened. So that's what we want. We want our officers to react in a standardized manner, if you will, or a manner in which they've been trained to react in. And as the sheriff said, we cannot train too often.
Absolutely.
Jefferson County Sheriff John Wallace and Madison Police Chief Dan Thurston joining us once again for Cop Talk, brought to you by Anderson Sales and Services. We'll be back to wrap things up on this edition of Cop Talk after this from Anderson's on Works 96.7. Works 96.7 WORX, good morning. Thank you for tuning back in as we wrap things up on this edition of Cop Talk, brought to you by Anderson Sales and Services. Cop Talk done the last Tuesday of each month. Jefferson County Sheriff John Wallace and Madison Police Chief Dan Thurston joining us once again for the program. As we say, guys, thank you guys so much for coming on the program.
Sure, absolutely. Thank you.
And as we wrap up, is there anything else you'd like to add before we go?
I would just say it is budget season. The chief and I always love budget season. Budget season is when we get with our councils and our mayors and our commissioners and hammer out our budget for next year. And I bring it up because, like I said, we spoke about the issues that we have in the jail, and I'm just very appreciative of the our county council and the commissioners and understanding the situation that we're facing in there, and their willingness to give me additional help, which should be coming the first of next year. So just wanted to just give them a thanks for understanding and for their willingness to help out with this situation. So
one thing I was going to add is I typically this time of year slept with the windows open and woke up this morning to a little chill in the air. And I know we'll have more Cop Talk between now and winter, but it's just a reminder that that time of the year is fastly approaching. Winter driving and staying safe and staying warm. I just wanted to kind of remind citizens that time of the year is right around the corner.
Yeah, and we definitely want people to stay safe out there.
Absolutely. That's the bottom line.
All right. Chief, Sheriff, thank you guys very much for coming on the program.
Thanks for having us. Yeah.
That is Jefferson County Sheriff John Wallace and Madison Police Chief Dan Thurston. Join us once again for Cop Talk. We do Cop Talk the last Tuesday of each month. That means we will see the Chief and the Sheriff again on October 25th. Until then, be sure to stay tuned to Works 96.7 WORX for the best of the 80s, 90s, and now. A big thanks to Anderson Sales and Services for sponsoring the program, the Chief and the Sheriff for coming on the program, and you, the listener, for tuning into the program. I'm AJ Brammer. Thanks for tuning in. Back to the music on Works 96.7 WORX.
I'm Greg Sanders, sales manager of Chandler Select here in Madison. As summer winds down and we start to head into fall and winter, the first thing on most people's mind is snow. And if you're going to be driving in that snow, you really need four-wheel drive or all-wheel drive. Here at Chandler Select, we've got a great selection of four-wheel drive trucks and SUVs, and something people don't think about are all-wheel drive cars. We've got a great selection of those too. So if you're worried about getting around this winter in the snow, come by Chandler Select and check out our selection of four-wheel drive and all-wheel drive vehicles. This is Chandler Select on Madison's Hilltop at 585 East Clifty Drive in front of Kroger, or visit our website at chandlerselect.com. Thanks for checking out our vehicles and have a great day.
We've made it down here where Andre's got all the costumes laid out for us, and you actually brought these from storage just so we could see them all, didn't you?
I did. I took it out of storage and brought it here to the house.
That's awesome. Where do y'all see all this stuff? Now, the one from Canada, you were telling us there's one from Canada that you had to get, and they actually are a Elvis certified costume company.
They are, and they're sanctioned by Elvis Presley Enterprises.
Right.
So you know you're going to get good quality material that's going to last a long time.
Oh my goodness. We're going to show you this one real quick. So hold on.
Oh my goodness.
Now tell us a little bit about this one.
Well, this is basically pretty much the best recognized Elvis outfit.
Right.
It's the Eagle jumpsuit that Elvis wore during the 73 Aloha concert, and it's an exact duplicate.
And it does have Elvis on the Eagle on the back.
Yes. And of course it has a matching cape and the matching belt that goes along with it. All approved by Elvis Presley Enterprises.
Right. Now how much does this one weigh?
This one's a light one. It probably weighs about 6 pounds, I'd say.
That's still, when you're on stage doing something, carrying 6 pounds is a little challenging sometimes.
Yes. And then you add the belt and that's a couple extra pounds as well.
Now the company that did this actually did all the beading for this one, didn't they?
Yes, they did. There's a lot of tedious work involved, and it's very professional.
It looks wonderful. It really does. Well, what's the next thing we have to show people?
Well, the next one, we're going to go back in time a little bit.
Right.
The next outfit that I have is a black and silver outfit. And this one, the stones on it are all glued down. They're not sewn down.
Oh.
So you have to find the product that's going to have the stones adhere to the material.
Right.
So when you wash the material, it's not going to fall off on you.
Oh, that's right.
And especially too with the heat, if you're doing a show, then it's not going to fall off during the middle of a show, you know, poke somebody in the eye. So we have to watch for that too. So you have to get good strong adhesive to make it last a long time.
And this one seems to be doing really well.
Yeah, this one is about, well, I'm going to say 18 years old.
Oh my goodness. And I don't see any beads missing. So whoever did a good job.
I did.
I know. he actually does some of his own costumes. And the neat thing is, you learned how to do this where?
Well, actually, when I was working at the prison, the inmates do a lot of handcraft stuff.
Right.
So they're the ones who taught me how to do this. My mother, who is also a seamstress, taught me some things as well. So the combination of both enabled me to be creative and copy this. Of course, there's no material pattern to get with this, so the pattern to come up with is all done by pictures.
Oh.
So I have to lay it out and draw it out that way.
And you take pictures of, you look at pictures that Elvis had the jumpsuits on, and then you take that pattern and you recreate it onto a jumpsuit.
Yes, and try to duplicate it. Otherwise, trying to purchase one of these outfits, very expensive.
Now here's the belt. This belt goes with the one that he's holding up now.
You see how it matches all up.
Yeah. Now, the neat thing about this is you did this too, didn't you?
Well, I put the stonework on here.
Yes.
The inmates at the prison made the belts for me themselves.
That's neat. You see the back, they actually did all the leather work. And then he's fixed it, and it just looks wonderful. It's really cool.
Now this jumpsuit, I actually started creating this back around 1993. So that's how old it is, gives you an idea.
Right.
And it weighs, this outfit itself weighs 9 pounds, and the belt weighs 9 pounds. So there's a total of about 18 pounds of wear on all this. And when you start shake, rattling, and rolling around, you're going to sweat a lot.
So this is 18 pounds that you jump around with.
Yes. And it, like I said, you sweat very
well. Do you wear this one very often?
Yes, I do.
Oh, my goodness.
And the back side of it as well is full of beads.
Now this one, you did all the beadwork.
I did. It took me a year to make it, and there's approximately 30,000 stones on this whole outfit.
And then you got the legs. You should see the legs here. Now we've got a little clip we're going to show you here in just a minute of the whole outfit, but this is just a close-up of the legs. So he has done an amazing job here.
So, and there's not too many tribute artists that actually wear these outfits.
Right.
And that's one of the things that intrigued me was everybody recognizes the White Eagle jumpsuit.
Right.
But some others don't wear this, or they may wear the ones that are fringes. So I wanted to capture something that's a little bit more unique.
Right. I think this is beautiful. This is just really cool. So now when you have a state trooper pull you over, you'll have a different image of the man. He's done an amazing job. I don't know if you can see this really well on the camera, but you can in a minute when we show you closer up. But the tedious work that he has done with these beads, you not only when you sew these on, you sew one or two on, you have to turn around and go back and you have to sew in between each bead to hold them down in the strand. And you can't see the thread work. It's just really beautiful. So I'm sure some people appreciate that.
Yes, they do. It makes it off with the realism.
Oh, it does. And this is heavy, I will tell you. I'm holding this for a little while, and it's very heavy. So.
And then I have one more outfit that I'm in the current process of making. And it's going to be another white outfit.
Right.
This
one you just started, right?
I started a long time ago. I just kind of put it aside and trying to get back to it. But there's some upcoming shows that are getting involved, so I want to work diligently, hopefully by next year.
Yes.
For the big concert for next year in August. We'd like to have it done by then. But I've been working on this diligently, and this is a lot more tedious than the previous outfit I just showed you.
I can tell. This one, how many beads do you sew down at a time?
This one, you take 5 stones at a time, and you sew it down, then you come back and loop in between each stone, like
right.
You mentioned earlier. So this takes a little bit more time to get it done. But laying out the pattern and coming up with the design, because like I said, there is no pattern to get. You just have to look at pictures and come up with your own.
Right. Now, how many rows of gold is this here? How many rows do you have so far of just the gold?
Well, just that one little spot, there's 5 rows.
5 rows just in that gold right there. So this is, when did you start this part? When did you start this?
Years ago.
Years ago.
But I, unfortunately, it doesn't take long to do it. I just set it down because of my rest of my activities and my job and
right,
stuff.
Right.
But like I said, I do want to get back to finishing it up. The belt, the matching belt that goes along with this is already done. There's some other parts that goes on the jumpsuit. It's already done. It's just a matter of putting it on, applying it. And then, of course, then I got this part here.
But got this bird to finish, and then you got one more to make.
There's another matching side to it on the other side, and then there's another bird you have to finish for the back side.
So you have 2 more pieces to finish besides this one to put it all together.
Yes.
Wow.
And then you sew it down onto the outfit itself.
Now, when you get it done in a year from now, we'll have to come back and look at it.
Absolutely.
That would be awesome.
We'll be wearing it for the next year's show.
Oh, wow. I just can't believe the work you do. You're very detailed. And I think that comes with being a detective with the state police, that you have that detail-oriented.
Look for the simplest little things and make
yes.
it work.
And then you turn around and do this. But I don't know if some people notice, this is also kind of therapy for him. You know, when you're working murder cases that take years to solve, this is something he accomplishes every day. He can come to the house and put a few things on here, and he's accomplished something during the day, and then he can turn around and go to the office and try to solve another crime or a murder, whatever it is you've got to do. So he has a little accomplishment during the day.
Yes. And, well, the other thing that goes along with all this to make all Elvis work is the singing. Everybody knows how to sing. A lot of people sing in the shower.
Yes.
I do sing in the shower sometimes. But at the same time, when you're out there performing Elvis songs, people listen to the music that you're singing.
Yes.
And there are some people, not necessarily Elvis performers, but there are some people that just sing words. But when you sing the songs with feelings and emotions, that comes across to the audience.
Yes, it does.
At the same time, though, if you're singing the songs, the audience is accepting that you might mess up a word or two here and there. But if you don't know the song, people are going to understand that too and realize
right.
that. So it's very crucial that you know the song. And we'll probably talk about that later on. But when you go up on stage, in my shows, I generally sing about 30 to 40 songs. That's a lot of words to remember to some songs. So we have fun with that. But the audience is forgiving if you mess up a little bit.
I think so. Yeah. I think they would be. But this is just wonderful. You're very detail-oriented to keep it authentic. I think that's the unique thing about Sam Yu. A lot of people call him by Sam Yu, by his last name. But I think it's really neat that he's very detailed and he tries to make it authentic. So when you go to see him as Elvis, you think you're seeing Elvis.
We try. So, thank you. Yes, we do.
Yeah, that's great. Now, do we have anything else to show them? We have you have your ring, I believe, is what we were going
to... Oh, yes.
Yeah?
Yes, I'll have to go get that.
Well, we're gonna wait for him to go get the ring, and we're going to look at that, and then he's got some other memorabilia back here that's really intriguing, so come go with us. Now, Nick,
Androlochus.
Androlochus gave you a ring that's really special to you. What was that for?
It is. Nick gave me this ring, and what it is a token of the next generation. Can you see that right there? Next generation of Elvis, tribute artist, or appreciation for Elvis, in that that Elvis handed out a necklace, a TCB necklace, to his constituents and the people that he liked and stuff.
Right.
And so Nick, in honor of what I was carrying on as a legacy for Elvis, basically accepted me into the fold with the other Elvis people in Elvis's life. And so Nick had this ring made up for me, especially for me. So it's a one-of-a-kind ring. And in that, it's a gold ring, oval shape on top, as you can see.
Right.
And then it has a TCB with a diamond inlay on that as well. And so this is kept at a local bank in a safe. I don't want nothing to happen to this.
No, that's a special gift. Now, for those people that are younger than we are and don't know who Nick is, tell them who Nick is.
Well, if you go to the airport, if you go to Graceland and look at the Lisa Marie jet that Elvis flew around in, Elvis would fly from Memphis to Denver to get Nick's sandwiches. Nick made the peanut butter, jelly, and bacon sandwiches, whereas Elvis was used to growing up with peanut butter, jelly, and banana sandwiches. Bananas were very prominent back in the South there. So Elvis fell in love with the situation. Nick ended up making the sandwiches for Elvis. And so Nick became very famous for that.
Right.
And so he has a little place out there called Nick's Cafe where everybody that knows Elvis, everybody that appreciates Elvis, goes and sees him. So that was a unique thing. And that's how. So if you go to Graceland, go to the airport, you'll see the story behind all this.
Right.
Very well famous.
This is beautiful. And you wear this during your concerts that you do.
On special concerts, yes, I'll wear it.
Special concerts. Mm-hmm. That's cool. Now, we have a few more things to show you.
Well, we're here in the hallway where he's got some of the pictures that have been sent to him or people have signed, and he's going to tell you a little bit about these. These are special pictures. Now, what's your most favorite one? Now, before we get to this, I'm going to step out of the way so you can see what he's doing here. So show us your special one.
Okay, thank you. This picture here is, of course, a picture of Elvis with Joe Esposito. Joe was Elvis's road manager. And when I did the concert at Morehead University a few years ago, Joe came out because we was doing a benefit concert for his wife, who was suffering and later died from cancer. So he came out, and as appreciation for that, he signed this picture for me and gave that to me ahead of time. Of course, it's dated 2011. And so the unique thing about that is Joe Esposito actually stayed at our house. And that's another, I guess, big thing in my life that I appreciate as far as authenticity goes and appreciation. So he did that. The other picture up here is, I'll remove this one picture, but this is a picture of Bobby Petrofesso and Elvis. Like I said, Elvis went to Denver a lot. And Bobby was a narcotics officer for the Denver Police Department. And so this check here represents a copy of Elvis purchasing a truck for Bobby Petrofesso. Bobby is a dear friend of mine, and we've become acquainted. And of course, and as time passes, we all change just a little bit. And this is a picture of Bobby now, as time's gone by. But Bobby, what his job was for Elvis when Elvis did do concerts in Denver, was to hold the curtain open for Elvis. And there was one moment in time when Bobby and Elvis were at the stage getting ready to come out for the performance, and Elvis asked Bobby if he's nervous. And Bobby says, I'm not nervous. I'm not the one going out there to sing in front of all these people. You are. So that kind of lightened the moment for both of them and said, had a good time. And then there's some others. This picture, what this represents is, this was given to me at a concert, that specific concert where Jerry Kennedy gave me the badge the day after. This was a concert that I had went to. And this is Bobby Petrofesso again. And then this is Nick Androlochus, who made Elvis's sandwiches. And so what happened was they came to the show, and they made a presentation to me of the group that watched over Elvis. And of course, it's here with Jerry Kennedy, Ron Petrofesso, Bobby's brother, Bobby Petrofesso, Robert Cantwell. Real quick about Robert, he was one of the detectives for the police department, ended up being the commissioner or the executive director for the prisons out in Colorado. And he had come to the prison where I was working at, and we had walked up the walkway to the prison one day, and he says, He says, "So I hear you have a pink Cadillac." And I said, "Well, yes, I do. I had a 58 pink Cadillac." And he says, "Well, I got the real thing." And he jingles out his keys. And Elvis gave him a Cadillac like he did many other people. And then there's a bunch of others as well, too. But this was given to me for the concert that I did on September 2011. And again, it's an honor to be recognized by those people that cherished Elvis as much, knowing that what my appreciation for Elvis and the legacy we try to create for others as well. So they gave me this presentation, this plaque, and I appreciate that. Yeah, the other thing we talked about before about Jerry Kennedy, and he was a captain at the time with the Denver Police Department, and he ended up being the chief of police at Denver.
Right.
Well, Elvis was a very badge collector, known for that. And so Jerry gave Elvis his lieutenant's badge. Well, after one of my concerts that I did, Jerry called me up and said, "I want you to meet me at Nick's for breakfast." So we go to Nick's for breakfast, and after we get done with the conversation, Jerry pulls in his pocket and hands me this badge. This badge is his very first badge. And I'll put it up to the camera so you can see there.
Yeah.
And the numbers on it is 57-26.
Right.
And what that represents is the 57 is the year that Jerry Kennedy graduated from the academy. There was two classes that year. And so the first class had cadets from 1 through 25. And then the second one was 26 through 50. Well, this badge is 57-26, which represents that Jerry was the first person to the honorary in his class, even though it was a second class.
Right.
So that's how that distinguishes that. So I told him that I didn't want this because this is a family heirloom that should be kept by the family.
Right.
But he insisted I have it because of the representation that we've done towards Elvis and the legacy of Elvis.
I think this goes back to what we were talking about earlier, is the authenticity that he does. You don't just sing a few of Elvis's songs. You don't just wear his jumpsuit. You become Elvis when you put this on. You are very authentic when you're playing Elvis.
We try to be. My theory has been that if you're going to portray Elvis, and especially for me, for, as you pointed out, detail-orientated, I want you to walk away from our shows to say, this is the closest to Elvis that we're going to get.
It's the closest you're going to get, so. Well, this is great. Now, some of the things that you do are your nonprofit organizations. And with those nonprofit things, you actually go and you do a concert for them, or some people pay you to come and do those concerts for those. And that's what's dearest to your heart, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Because obviously I'm not going to make any money doing this, but we do raise a lot of money for the local charities.
Right.
And whether it's you sing to one person or you sing to a multitude of people, it's all for the cause of a specific organization that I get invited to. And that's the treat. For me, the payoff is to see the glimmer in somebody's eyes that appreciates the music.
What's the largest crowd you've sung to?
About 5,000 people.
Would that make you a little bit nervous?
Every show, whether it's 25 people, I'm still nervous.
You're nervous whether it's 5 or 25?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. Now, is there any way people can contact you in order to have you sing at their event? Or
they can call. I'll put it out there. I'll give them my personal cell phone number, and that's 859-398-8668. And when you call that number, you'll be talking to me. And we have an upcoming concert that I'm inviting everybody to. It's going to be on October 15th, 2015 at the City Place in LaGrange. The concert is going to benefit the Kentucky State Police Shop of the Trooper program for the kids and also for the Crisis Pregnancy Center in LaGrange. So we welcome everybody to come out there. The tickets are $20 in advance. You call my cell phone number. We'll make arrangements about the transaction, about the cost and the tickets. And then if you want to wait until get them at the door, they're $25 at the door. And there's no special seating. Everybody just first come, first serve.
Well, this is great that you've been with us. I really appreciate this. And I appreciate everything that you do. This is great that you give back to the community the way you do.
Well, thank you very much for having me. Appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. So we're going to check back in with him again in another time, and we're going to check out the outfit that he's making. Hopefully it'll be done before the year's up.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And as always, thank you for watching. Thank you.
I'm Joyce Doyle, the 4-H agent, and am I so excited. We've got a new thing going here in Carroll County. Ever since I've been here, I wanted to start a teen council. Boy, have we got it going. We have four of the most wonderful teens who are leaders in our county going to take the roles of the officers of this wonderful council, and we've invited 15 other leaders to be a part of the 4-H council. So from here, from month to month, I'll be filling in on what's going on with the youth of Carroll County with this wonderful 4-H Teen Council.
Hello, my name is Andrea Searcy, and I'm excited to be the president of our new 4-H Teen Council in Carroll County. 4-H means to me an opportunity, a great opportunity for both youth and adults. There's something for everybody in it. Some of the experiences that I've had was working with animals like chickens and rabbits and gardening. And then there's arts and crafts like quilting or paper crafts. And this year I had 52 things go to the state fair, and 41 of those were blue ribbons. And I look forward to working with Joyce in the future.
Boy, was a state fair full of things from Carroll County this year. We took 102 items to the state fair and came home with 89 blue ribbons. Now, I'm going to tell you something out there. A blue ribbon is not easy to get at the Kentucky State Fair, but Carroll County brought it home. So excited with all the exhibits that we had at the state fair. So proud of the youth of Carroll County.
Hi, my name is Kinley Huseman, and I'm the vice president of the Carroll County Teen Council. 4-H isn't just an organization, it's basically my life. I love how 4-H is open to everyone, and it teaches you many life skills. 4-H has taught me how to become a great leader and many responsibility skills. The main thing I do in 4-H is I shoot trap. I am a certified teen trap shooting coach by the University of Kentucky. In 4-H, I have ranked 6th in the state at the 4-H state shoot. Because of 4-H, I have made lots of new friends and learned lots of new skills. In 4-H, I look forward to growing as a leader and ranking higher in state next year.
Hi, my name is Madeline Watts, and I am the secretary and treasurer to the Carroll County Teen Council. And to 4-H, to me, 4-H means to express yourself. Through 4-H, I have learned to speak more fluently and be more outgoing, and I've done a lot of speeches through 4-H, and usually before I started 4-H, I didn't want to speak at all in front of people, and so this has really pushed me to be a better me. And 4-H to me also means shooting sports. I am a teen coach, I'm an archery, and my dad also does 4-H, so he really pushes me to do everything in 4-H, like exhibits for the state fair and the leadership programs. Because leadership, to me, is a big part of 4-H also. Because everyone needs to be able to show that they can be in control of something that needs control of. And also, through 4-H, I met one of my best friends. And I'll never be able to show how thankful I am for that, because she means the world to me. And eventually, I want to be able to work with Joyce through 4-H, and I know that 4-H can let me do that.
Good evening. My name is Clara Tuttle, and I am excited to be the reporter of our new 4-H Teen Council in Carroll County. What 4-H means to me is learning more about yourself and the great opportunities that you will have in life. What I have done in 4-H is doing speeches, showing lambs, arts and crafts, sewing, and tobacco. I would like to see more people involved in 4-H, and if you are interested, please come by and see Ms. Joyce.
If you would like to join 4-H, just call the office here at 502-732-7030, and we would be glad to send you a form to fill out where you can become a member of Carroll County 4-H. So if you want to join, there's something for everyone. In October, we will be hosting the pottery class on October 22nd. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Searcy Monument Company, Kentuckiana News, and the News Democrat for always supporting Carroll County 4-H.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Debbie Crawford, and we were here with Steve Zimmer. You are with who, Steve?
Well, I'm here representing Imaginarium Convention in its third year this year.
Oh my goodness. Now, Imaginarium doesn't really tell you what this event is about, so you want to tell everybody what the event really is?
I sure will. It's a convention that's all about creative writing. And when I say that, I mean all genres. We're talking mystery, we're talking romance, we're talking fantasy, science fiction, everything. And not only that, we're also talking about writing in terms of screenwriting for movies.
Right.
We're talking about writing for game design, which would lead to your video games and things like that, and comic creators. So when we talk writing, it's a broad picture.
And then you're going to have different people there teaching small courses.
Oh yes, all 3 days. It's content rich. I mean, it has all the content of a major writers' conference. It's got over 100 panels and probably about 20 to 25 workshops place through the 3-day period, and they cover everything from the craft of writing to all the genres to how to get published. Things about blogging. I mean, we cover every topic you can possibly imagine.
Now, how many publishing companies are going to be at this event?
There's going to be quite a few. I need to check on our latest count. But we definitely have, I know there's at least 6 that are taking pitch sessions at
the
event. 6 that are taking actual formal scheduled pitch sessions at the event. But there's many more than that that are in attendance or have representatives attending. And so we do have a nice diverse group of publishers that will be present.
Now, who are the people you're really targeting that you want them to come to this event? Is there anyone specific, or is this a wide group of...
Well, the thing about this is that it does have a lot of great programming content, but it also has a lot of the fun stuff. I mean, we have a film festival, we have a full-blown expo, and that's open to the general public for free. And we also have things like gaming, we have a masquerade and costume contest, we have live entertainment, including like a magician and a hypnotist, and all kinds of fun stuff. So honestly, I mean, people, readers, people from the general public, people that like books and movies, I mean, they would have a lot of fun at it, but at the same time, it's also very targeted to writers, filmmakers, gaming people, comic creators, artists, creative folks.
So people that want to actually learn to write can go to this. Mm-hmm. If you're already writing a book and you want to know how to publish it or how to make it better, you can go to this. You also have people that will edit things for them.
Oh, we have many amazing pro editors that are going to be there. They'll be on panels. They'll be easy to meet and talk to.
Right.
The thing about our guests that's wonderful is they're very easy to approach. I mean, people that do not have any books published or anything,
have
no problem talking to people that have actually done editing work for like New York Times bestselling authors.
Oh.
It's a really nice environment, and the kind of guests we have are really approachable. So,
so
people can get their questions answered.
And I know a couple of them that love red ink. So,
most editors do.
I don't like red ink, but these guys love to get a hold of a book and make it look better. So if you have all that red ink in your novel, it's not being mean or hateful.
Yeah, it's not being.
No,
they're
just
constructive.
Constructive. They're trying to make it better for you and the reader when they buy your book. So I just get tickled when somebody says, "I can't wait to get my red ink pen out."
Oh yes. Those editors are fond of that.
They do love that, don't they?
Yeah.
So now, the dates of this event are?
They're October the 7th through October the 9th, and that's a Friday through a Sunday.
Friday through a Sunday. So there really is 2 weeks from now.
Mm-hmm.
So if they want to be there. And then can you tell maybe some of the times of different things that's going to be going on?
Sure.
You know,
Friday, the panel programming, the panels and workshops and things, start about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And we have big opening ceremonies event at 9 o'clock. And then at 10 o'clock, we start an evening of entertainment on that Friday. And the Saturday is a massive day. I mean, we start our day probably about 10 a.m. And, I mean, it'll go all the way to midnight. I mean, and it's filled with... I mean, the vendor hall, I mean, everything runs concurrently. And if you go on our website, you can see, there's more stuff to do than you possibly can do. So you have to almost like look at our schedule and almost make your plan on what you want to do.
Choose the things that you want to sit in on.
Choose the thing, yeah. And so it's quite a bit. And then Sunday will run from roughly about 10 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Now, where can they go to get an actual scheduling of this? What is there a website? Is there a Facebook page? Where is the actual schedule for this that they can find easily?
Yeah, if you find us on social media, on Twitter or Facebook or anything, we always have links going back to their website. Our website is entertheimaginarium.com.
Entertheimaginarium.com
is the address. But if you find us on Facebook under Imaginarium Convention or Twitter or any social media, I mean, you can always, I mean, we have links to our sites everywhere on our social media.
Everything crosses over nowadays.
So they can just link right into our site.
Right.
And we'll also, in addition to our site, toward the event, we'll also go live with an event-based app that people can download on their phones.
That
schedule is kept up to date so people can actually navigate the convention using that phone app.
Right. Oh, that's awesome. I think this is really neat because I know when I was younger, I had friends that loved to write books, but they didn't know who to talk to publish the book. They didn't know who to talk to as far as getting artwork done for a book or even how the book should begin. They just knew they wanted to write a book and they wrote it, but they didn't have a beginning. You know, how do you start the book? And we had no one to go to. Well, now you've got this. If you want to write a book or if you're thinking, do I really want to write this book? How involved is it going to be? You can go down here and ask them. You can find out how intense it is, people you need to talk to, artwork, whatever. Mm-hmm. It's there. So.
And we give you all the options, too, because, we have a true mix of all types of publishing.
Yes.
We have people that are self-published. We have people that are small press and independent press. I mean, one of our featured guests is Jason Sizemore, who runs Apex Book Company, which is one of the best independent presses in the nation. And then you have people that are dealing with the major press. Editors and writers and people like that. One of our imaginators, Elizabeth Beverly, is a New York Times bestselling romance author.
Oh, yeah.
And so she knows how to deal with the major press. And I mean,
so
we've got people on all levels. And so basically, no matter what your goal is with your book, I mean, you can find people that can talk to that.
And it's not just the publishers. You have all different artists that can design the book cover, or they can design the artwork inside the book, or just design your logo even. You know, they can go little or make it really huge, but it's just neat to have all that resource under one building.
Oh yes,
for the weekend.
Yeah, and like I say, it's the environment is what it makes it so great, because it's not it's very inclusive, it's very welcoming, it's not stuffy. It's a kind of place where people can sit down and talk and meet each other, and it's comfortable, so it's easy for people to connect and network. And so
I noticed
that's one thing I've driven hard to develop. And if you look at our testimonials, I mean, I think we've definitely achieved that.
I think you have achieved that. Yeah, I noticed that the last interview we did together, that any question that was asked during that day, everybody was very helpful. It didn't matter how big of a question it was, if they had to go do research for it, they stopped and they went and looked it up, or they answered the question and then the next person would come up and ask a question. So it was very impressive to me that everybody took time for whoever was there.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
and
so that's
the kind of world we have. So
And I think that's what makes it successful.
And we do work hard to get the right kinds of guests, the kinds of people that are approachable. Yeah, very much so.
Yeah, I think you all do that. So,
well,
now,
you.
Is there anything else we need to make sure they know before we send them off? Make sure they come to...
I encourage people to try it out, because everybody that tries it out just loves it and returns.
Right.
And so, you can get day passes. So if you only want to come one day, you can get day passes. And I do advise people to pre-register, because then people that are registered can sign up for the really high-end workshop slots. There are no extra charges for that. When you register, you have access to everything Imaginarium. There's nothing, no additional charges. So
now, what is the registration fee?
Our weekend registration for all 3 days is $65.
Oh my goodness!
And that covers.
That's not,
and when you compare that to writers' conferences that charge $200-$400 for registration, and then you look at what we offer. I mean, it's the value is amazing. So, and you look at most larger conventions and stuff now. I mean, they're all charging in that range. Period. Even for fan conventions.
Yes, they are. But I think this one's a little different because this is very dear to your all's heart. Everybody that's involved with this one, this is more of a passionate type event, because
it's a passion project.
You're all passionate about it, and you want to share that with people that are interested in the same thing.
Absolutely.
So I think that...
And we've been there where we, needed somebody to go to, or needed somebody to help us, and that's not been there. We understand what that's like, and so this is our chance to help that
process. And it's a chance to give back.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
That's great.
So we try to make it as accessible as possible, and so that's why we keep our registrations on the lower scale, so people can be there.
Well, I hope you have a wonderful event.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, you're welcome, and thanks for being here. This is great.
Thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
Well, this is Debbie Crawford, and you need to check out this event and see if it's something you would be interested in. I think you'd enjoy it. So try to make it out. Thanks for watching.